فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
الشيخ شيخ الإسلام ابن تيمية. This last chapter, we're going to go through 14 points, inshallah ta'ala, and that will be the ending of this small explanation of the khulasa fi muqaddimat fi usul al-tafsir. This last chapter, the author, rahimahullah, he speaks about the most important thing, which is how and what method is the Qur'an explained and commented on. And this is a question he puts to himself first, and then he, rahimahullah, he responds to that question. He says, the first one,
if one were to ask, what is the best method of tafsir?
فَإِنْ قَالَ قَائِلٌ فَمَا أَحْسَنُ تُرُكِ التَّفْسِيرُ.
So he started by asking a question. And the reason why he did that is to get your attention, the one who's reading. Because when something is made in a question and an answer manner, it gets the attention of the one who's reading than if it was just made into a direct speech without involving you in. The question here is a rhetorical question. The Sheikh doesn't want the answer from you. He's actually going to tell you. And that's the path that the Prophet ﷺ took in explaining to the companions in many situations. He says to them, "Atadruna, do you know what day it's today? Do you know?" And they would say, "Allah wa Rasulu a'lam," and then he would respond to them. Even the long famous hadith of Jibreel, to teach them, Jibreel had to come and make it into a question and an answer session. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was being questioned, and the Prophet would answer, and the companions would sit there and watch. And when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is said to, "What is Islam?" the Prophet would give the answer. They would look at the Prophet, and then when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam answers, the second question is put to him. And then the Prophet answers the second question, and then the third question is put to him, and then the Prophet ﷺ answers it. This has more engaging for the student than to just directly speak. And this is turuq, a path of the paths to teach and to educate. And as you can see, this is something that's taught in courses of education and methods of teaching. And this is something that the Sharia has already observed while back. So the question here is, فَمَا أَحْسَنُ, what is the best method of commenting on the Qur'an? Then the Shaykh rahimahullah يقول مجيباً, he says in response to that,
the response would be that the most authentic of methods is to first explain the Qur'an with the Qur'an. This is because what is mentioned briefly in one place will be expounded upon in another place, and what is summarized in one place will be explained in detail elsewhere.
فالجواب إن أصح طرقي في ذلك أن يفسر القرآن بالقرآن فما أجمل في مكان فإنه قد فسر في موضع آخر وما اختصر في مكان فقد بسط في موضع آخر.
If you are unable to do this, then use the Sunnah, as it is an explanation of the Quran. Thus, if you do not find the tafsir in the Qur'an or Sunnah, you return to the statements of the companions.
فَإِنْ أَعْيَاكَ ذَلِكَ فَعَلَيْكَ بِالسُّنَّةِ فَإِنَّهَا شَارِحَةٌ لِلْقُرْآنِ وَمُوَضِّحَةٌ لَهُ وَإِذَا لَمْ تَجِدِ التَّفْسِيرَ فِي الْقُرْآنِ وَلَا فِي السُّنَّةِ رَجَعْتَ فِي ذَلِكَ إِلَىٰ أَقْوَالِ الصَّحَابَةِ.
The Sheikh, rahimahullah, when it came to commenting on the Qur'an, in the response, he gave us four things. In point one and point two, both of them, he mentions four. The first one is tafsir al-Qur'an bil-Qur'an. To comment on the Qur'an with the Qur'an. And he explains to you, فَمَا أُجْمِلَ, wherever you find ambiguity and it's not clear, فَإِنَّهُ قَدْ فُسِّرَ فِي مَوْضِعٍ آخَرَ, it has been explained and it has been expanded on in other places. That's the first one. The second one is what? The second one is tafsir al-Qur'an bis-sunnah. The Shaykh, that's where he said, فَإِنْ أَعْيَاكَ ذَلِكَ فَعَلَيْكَ بِالسُّنَّةِ. If you can't find the Qur'an explaining itself, then go to the sunnah. The third one is tafsir al-Qur'an bi-aqwali al-sahaba. وَإِذَا لَمْ تَجِدِ التَّفْسِيرَ فِي الْقُرْآنِ وَلَا فِي السُّنَّةِ رَجَعْتَ فِي ذَلِكَ إِلَىٰ أَقْوَالِ الصَّحَابَةِ. The fourth one, which is tafsir al-Qur'an bi-aqwali al-tabi'in. Then the author, rahimahullah, mentions after that. He mentions it. We're going to see it bi idhnillahi al-kareem later. He's going to bring the aqwal of the tabi'in. Now here we have to stand over each one. Tafsir al-Qur'ani bil-Qur'ani is of two ways it comes. There's two tariqah, two ways that tafsir al-Qur'ani bil-Qur'ani occurs. فَهُوَ النَّوْعَانِ. The first one is tafsir al-Qur'ani bil-Qur'ani sarahatan. The Qur'an comments on itself and explains itself directly. Such as when you read قَوْلُهُ تَعَالَى, the statement of Allah, وَمَا أَدْرَاكَ مَا يَوْمُ الدِّينِ ثُمَّ مَا أَدْرَاكَ مَا يَوْمُ الدِّينِ. So what does the يَوْمُ الدِّينِ here mean? Because the both ayahs say, وَمَا أَدْرَاكَ, what do you know about يَوْمُ الدِّينِ? Then Allah said, ثُمَّ, after that, then what do you know about the يَوْمُ الدِّينِ? Then Allah explains it to you. يَوْمَ لَا تَمْلِكُ نَفْسٌ لِنَفْسٍ شَيْئًا وَالْأَمْرُ يَوْمَئِذٍ لِلَّهِ. It's the day when no one whatsoever can help, can aid anybody, and can do anything for them. وَالْأَمْرُ يَوْمَئِذٍ لِلَّهِ, and the matter is for Allah that day. So now if somebody asks you, what is يَوْمُ الدِّينِ? Your answer is, يَوْمَ لَا تَمْلِكُ نَفْسٌ لِنَفْسٍ شَيْئًا وَالْأَمْرُ يَوْمَئِذٍ لِلَّهِ. That's the tafsir which is sarih, which the Qur'an did for itself, explains it. صح? The second one is tafsir al-Qur'ani bil-Qur'ani ala wajhi al-dhuhuri. The second one is that tafsir of the Qur'an with the Qur'an based on that which seems apparent. It seems apparent and is not direct. It seems direct. For example, amma yatasa'alun, what is it that they are asking you about? Anin naba'il azim. Anin naba'i al-azim, the great news. Naba'il azim, ikhtilaf happened amongst the mufassirin regarding what is it, what's meant by it. Everyone took a verse from the Quran and said that's what is meant by it. And in Naba'il Azim, everyone took a verse and said this is what's meant by it, the Naba'il Azim that the Prophet was being asked. Are you with me? But each one is bringing a what? And another ayah for it. And he said, my ayah is tafsir al-Qur'ani bil-Qur'an. Another one said, no, my one is right. All of them based is what? Based on what seems apparent to them. Okay? That one, the first one, we can say this is maqtu'un bih. Allah said it. This is the qawl. We can't dispute it. The first one which we mentioned. وَمَا أَدْرَاكَ مَا يَوْمُ الدِّينِ ثُمَّ مَا أَدْرَاكَ مَا يَوْمُ الدِّينِ يَوْمَ لَا تَمْلِكُ نَفْسُ لِنَفْسٍ شَيْئًا وَالْأَمْرُ يَوْمَئِذٍ لِلَّهِ. You can't deny that. Clearly the ayah says that. As for the second one, which is ظاهر, which is قوي, you can say this is strong, but you can't say it is it. There's no, this is it. خلاص. No one can go against me on it. And you can't say this is the intent by the verse. You can't. The second one, which is tafsir al-Qur'ani bis-sunnah. Tafsir al-Qur'ani bis-sunnah, which we already spoke about at the beginning, right? We spoke about that, the issue tafsir al-Qur'ani bis-sunnah. We already spoke about it. We said tafsir khasun mu'ayyanun, like the hadith of Adi ibn Hatim, remember, which we mentioned, where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said مغضوب عليهم are the Yahud, and the ضالين are the Nasara. This is tafsir khasun mu'ayyan. The Prophet specifically commented on this verse. Commented on it specifically, alayhi salatu wasalam. The second one is tafsir am. It's a general tafsir of the Prophet. And that is when you observe his seerah, his sunnah, his actions. Just like when Allah said, subhanahu wa ta'ala, aqim as-salata li duluki ash-shamsi ila ghasaqi al-layli wa qur'an al-fajr, inna qur'an al-fajri kana mashhuda. We say this, we can only know it, the mawaqitu as-salah, based on the Prophet's actions. So we have to go to the Sunnah. And Imam Malik rahimahullah, Ibn Anas, in his Muwatta, the first chapter he starts with his Muwatta is what? Muwaqitu salah. Muwaqitu salah. And Imam Malik, he starts his Muwatta with the timing of the prayer. That's the second type of tafsir. The third type of tafsir is tafsir al-Qur'ani bi aqwali sahaba. The tafsir of the Qur'an based on the speech of the companions. And that's of two types. That is of two types. Are you with me, brothers? The first one is ما نقلوه عن أهل الكتاب. Are you with me, brothers? ما نقلوه عن أهل الكتاب. That which they transmitted from the people of the book. And we spoke about that already, right? We spoke about that. We don't have to go back to that. The second type of the tafsir of the Sahabas is ما قالوه, that which they have said, من عند أنفسهم, from themselves. لا بالنقل عن أهل الكتاب. They didn't transmit it from the people of the book. Are you with me? And this we said, this one we said, that Ibn al-Qayyim strengthened and he argued that this one is له حكم الرفع, is given the حكم of رفع. Because the Sahabas wouldn't comment on a verse unless they took it from the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. That's what Ibn al-Qayyim says. So now we took the first four points of the first four points that the author said. Right now we took 4 points already. So you guys have to just read. You read three for me, right? You're now going to read the fourth one. I already commented on the fourth one. The fourth one is what? One of the tafsir of the Sahabas. Remember, Shaykh goes into the issue of Israiliyat, right? This goes to the issue of the Sahabas. We already mentioned it. One of the Sahabas, the way they transmit it. Na'am.
But sometimes they would transmit from them sayings of the people of the book, which the Prophet ﷺ allowed in his statement, convey from me even if it is a verse, and there is no harm in narrating from the children of Israel, but whosoever intentionally ascribes lies to me will take his place in the fire. Collected by Al-Bukhari from the hadith of Abdullah ibn Amr.
ولكن في بعض الأحيان ينقل عنهم ما يحكونه من أقاويل أهل الكتاب التي أباحها رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, حيث قال: بلغوا عني ولو آية وحدثوا عن بني إسرائيل ولا حرج, ومن كذب علي متعمدا فليتبوأ مقعده من النار. رواه البخاري عن عبد الله بن عمرو.
That falls under the second type that the first type that we mentioned from the tafsir of the Sahabas, right? And who is it referring to here? Specifically, Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As. And then others who were said that they do the same. That's the point that the Shaykh is mentioning, the tafsir of the Sahabas. The tafsir of the Sahabas who took from the people of the book. Who took from the people of the book.
No. However, these Israelite traditions are quoted as supporting evidences and not primary sources. These traditions are three types. A type which is authentic, as its truthfulness is attested to by our own sources. A type which is false, as our own sources reject it. And a third type which does not fall into the previous two categories. We neither judge it to be authentic or inauthentic. As such, we neither believe in it nor reject it. One is allowed to quote from this third type, even though most of what is contained in it is of no immediate benefit.
ولكن هذه الأحاديث الإسرائيلية تذكر للاستشهاد لا للاعتقاد.
The Sheikh رحمه الله, he says here that the hadith Israiliyat, using the narrations of the Israiliyat, it is mentioned. It is only mentioned as lil istishhad. Istishhad means supporting evidence. You already have your evidences. You have ayat that support you already. You have ahadith that support you already. You're just mentioning it to strengthen it. So this is also in the previous books. Not that you're trying to use it as your primary source. It's not your asal that you're trying to use your argument for. Are you with me, brothers? So when is it not allowed to use the Israiliyat? To make the Israiliyat your what? Your primary source. But are you allowed to use the Israiliyat as your, what do you call it? Your supporting evidence? Yes, you can. Because regardless of whether it is or not, you've already got evidence to support your argument. Then the author, rahimahullah, tells us,
فإنها على ثلاثة أقسام.
So the Israiliyat is not of one color, one level. It's of three levels. The first one is
أحدها ما علمنا صحتها مما بأيدينا مما يشهد له بالصدق فذاك صحيح.
The first one is ما علمنا صحته. We know its authenticity. How do we know its authenticity? مما بأيدينا مما يشهد له بالصدق. Our Quran or the Hadith attests to it. Are you with me? When the Prophet ﷺ and the Jew man came, the one we took in Kitab al-Sifat, the Imam Dar al-Qutni, the Jew man came, and what did he say? When the Jew man came, and he mentioned that Allah places the samawat on one usbu', the aradin of one usbu', the earth on one usbu', the sea on one usbu', the five. And then the Prophet ﷺ smiled and he said, وَالسَّمَاوَاتُ مَطْوِيَّاتٌ بِيَمِينِ سُبْحَانَ وَتَعَالَى عَمَّا يُشْرِكُونَ وَالسَّمَاوَاتُ مَطْوِيَّاتٌ بِيَمِينِ نعم. The Prophet recited this ayah for him. What was this ayah for? Attesting to what he just said right now. You're right. Where did he get that from? He got it from his own book, right? But the Prophet ﷺ attested to him and said, نعم, صحيح. He attested to the عليه الصلاة والسلام. فذاك السهل. We take that now. We actually take that now because we have a backing argument for it. Second.
والثاني ما علمنا كذبه مما عندنا مما يخالفه.
The second one is that which we know, it's a lie. They made that up. They were the ones who added that to their religion. Are you with me? It's from the things that يحرفون الكلمة عن مواضعه. They actually changed it and they tampered it. And that's too much to mention. It is too much to mention. So much of their religion which they changed. Are you?
والثالث ما هو مسكوت عنه لا من هذا القبيل ولا من هذا القبيل فلا نؤمن به ولا نكذبه وتجوز حكايته لما تقدم وغالب ذلك مما لا فائدة فيه تعود إلى أمر ديني.
The third one is ما هو مسكوت عنه. Our Sharia was silent about it. Are you with me, brothers? Our Sharia what? Is silent about it. That one is permissible to talk about. Based on the hadith that the Shaykh rahimahullah is going to bring later. Oh, he already brought, right? بَلِّغُ عَنِّي وَلَوْ آيَا وَحَدِّثُ عَنْ بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلَ وَلَا حَرَجْ وَمَنْ كَذِبْ عَلَيَّ مُتَعَمِّدًا فَلَيَتَبَوَّ مَقْعَدَهُ مِنَ النَّارِ بَلِّغُ عَنِّي وَلَوْ آيَا وَحَدِّثُ عَنْ بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلَ. Talk about Bani Israel. That's the one. You can talk about them. Are you with me? This hadith shows that you can't talk about them. But Shaykh al-Islam mentions, وَغَالِبُ ذَلِكَ مِمَّا لَا فَإِدَةَ فِيهِ تَعُودُ إِلَىٰ أَمْرِ الدِّينِ. There's no really benefit that comes back to the religion. Talking about it doesn't bring benefits. There's nothing taken out of it that's very beneficial. So even if you do talk about it, and you mention it, there's no religious benefit that can be taken. There's no religious benefit that can be taken out of it. Na'am. So now, if you guys still remember, when it came to the tafsir, I mentioned already three. There's one missing, right? Tabi'in is missing. So Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah went off on the issue of the Isra'iliyat. So now we're going to come back to the issue of the Tabi'in. This is number 7 now.
The scholars of the people of the book differ considerably regarding this third category. And as a result, the scholars of tafsir quote from them and also differ in this regard. And other such matters which are not detailed in the Quran, which possess no direct benefit in worldly or religious affairs. However, one may mention the difference of opinion in these matters.
ولهذا يختلف علماء أهل الكتاب في مثل هذا كثيرا ويأتي عن المفسرين خلاف بسبب ذلك مما لا فائدة في تعيينه تعود على المكلفين في دنياهم ولا في دينهم ولكن نقل الخلاف عنهم في ذلك جائز.
This is the issue that we mentioned, like the people of Ahlul Kahf. The Ahlul Kahf, what are they? The narrations pertaining to that, people do bring a lot of narrations from Ahl Ben Israel to try to mention who they were. This now, knowing it, is it going to benefit anything in your religion? If you find out what dog is it going to benefit you? The water of Nuh, is it going to benefit you? Things like that, that you find out from Ben Israel, the knowledge of it and the absence of it is the same to you. Wujudu ka'adamu. Its presence, like it's like its absence. So you don't really take anything from it. You can mention it if you wish to. You can say it, but there's nothing that it comes back to that can be taken out of it. Na'am.
If one is unable to find the explanation of a verse in the Quran or Sunnah and does not find any relevant commentaries from the companions, then many of the scholars use the statements of the successors. Their statements are quoted and at times there is difference in wording, but those who are not grounded in knowledge believe it to be differences of opinion and quote it as such. This is not the case, as some of them mention something by using examples or similes, whilst others are explicit in what they are referring to. Most of the time they are in agreement, so let the state be aware of this, and guidance is from Allah.
إذا لم تجد التفسير في القرآن ولا في السنة ولا وجدته عن الصحابة فقد رجع كثير من الأئمة في ذلك إلى أقوال التابعين فتذكر أقوالهم في الآية فيقع في عباراتهم تباين في الألفاظ يحسبها من لا علم عنده اختلافا فيحكيها أقوالا وليس كذلك فإن منهم من يعبر عن الشيء بلازمه أو نظيره ومنهم من ينص على الشيء بعينه والكل بمعنى واحد في كثير من الأماكن فليتفطن اللبيب لذلك والله الهادي.
The Shaykh rahimahullah, he talks about the issue of now the fourth one, which is the tafsir of the tabi'een. The tafsir of who? The tabi'een. And the tafsir of the tabi'een, the Shaykh says, وَإِذَا لَمْ تَجِدِ التَّفْسِيرَ فِي الْقُرْآنِ وَلَا فِي السُّنَّةِ وَلَا وَجَدْتَهُ عَنِ الصَّحَابَةِ فَقَدْ رَجَعَ كَثِيرٌ مِنَ الْأَئِمَّةِ فِي ذَلِكَ إِلَىٰ أَقْوَالِ التَّابِعِينَ. If you look at the Quran, and then you look at the Sunnah, and you look at the statements of the Sahaba, and you don't find any of that, are you with me, brothers? Then you go towards the tafsir of the tabi'een. And many of the scholars have actually done that. And then the Shaykh rahimahullah mentions, are you with me? That sometimes you may find different wordings from the tabi'een. And people may think there's actually four or five different views within the tabi'een in this matter. But it really isn't the case. And he mentions that that's incorrect. And of course, as we mentioned when we were speaking about dalalatul mutabaq and dalalatul tadammun and dalalatul iltizam, we mentioned that. That that's the usage and that's how the ikhtilaful tanawu' occurs. We've already spoken about that previously. But the tafsir of the tabi'een is of two types. There's a tafsir ma ajma'u alayhi, which they unanimously agreed upon. فَهَذَا حُجَّةٌ, that's a proof, that's an evidence. They all of them agreed on it together. That's an ijma', you have to take it. If the tabi'een agree on a tafsir of the Qur'an, then you have to take it. You have no other choice. The second is, مَخْتَلَفُوا فِيهِ, they differed it with amongst themselves. And this is not a hujjah now, it's not a proof. It's not a... So what do you do in this situation? What you do in this situation is that you go to qara'in, you find other factors that may strengthen between their speeches. Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah is going to give us the qara'in to distinguish between it. You either look at the lughatul al-Qur'an, you start looking at the language of the Qur'an, or you start looking at the language of the Sunnah. Normally, how does the Sunnah use this word? Are you with me, brothers? Or you look at what's the most common usage of the Arabs. Which one do they come, whenever they say this word, what's the first meaning that comes to mind? We strengthen it based on that, if there has a khilaf amongst them. Are you with me? If that happens, that's what we do. And the question that arises is, are you with me? Some may say that has it happened that the tafsir that wasn't found in the Quran and then it wasn't found in the Sunnah and then it wasn't found in the Sahabas, then it was found in the Tabi'in and only the Tabi'in spoke about it? Na'am, there is. Like qawluhu ta'ala tajri tahtaha al-anhar, the word tajri is Surah Al-Uqdud. Are you with me? They're the only ones who spoke, gave the tafsir of the jiryan that takes place here. You can go back to Surah Al-Uqdud, we don't want to go too much into it. As it was transmitted from the Tabi'in, Masruq and others. No one before them commented on that. And that tafsir is a hujjah, because the tabi'een within themselves, they didn't differ upon it. They did not differ upon themselves. They didn't differ themselves. Sometimes what you find is some people don't have understanding of the tafsir of the Quran. They don't distinguish between the tabi'een like that. Are you with me? Because if the tabi'een within themselves agree upon a tafsir, are you with me? And it becomes ijma' amongst themselves. It's ignorant on your side to say, هذا لا دليل عليه من القرآن والسنة. There's no dalil from the Quran and the Sunnah in this matter. But their ijma' is an evidence. Their consent is an evidence. Are you with me? So that's incorrect. Also, are you with me? Also, the tabi'een are from the Qurun al-Mufaddala. They're from the three noble generation who the Prophet ﷺ praised. خير الناس قرني ثم الذين يلونهم ثم الذين يلونهم. So they're the third noble generation who the Prophet praised alayhi salatu wasalam. So for you to just dismiss them like they're equal to the rest of the ummah, is not giving value to why the Prophet ﷺ placed them in the Qurun al-Mufaddala. Sah? So that's why the Shaykh rahimahullah, he brought him here. Then the Shaykh goes to a point that some may bring as an argument. Some people are going to say to you, well, if that's the case, I'm going to take the call of Shu'bah ibn Hajjaj, Abu Bistam al-Ataki. And we're now going to bring his speech, which is the next point.